One of the areas of discipline that we want to understand more effectively is the management of intellectual property assets. And as the importance of intellectual property in transactions increases consistently and regularly, I think it's important for us to start to drill into these issues and understand transaction structures and opportunities for value. And so, but actually, Michael and I worked together on a program many years ago when some activist investors came in and said, hey, there's a lot of intellectual property and you're not monetizing it. And they had quite a strong issue with that. And those issues are just as pertinent today. And so Michael Friedman's going to lead us through the next session looking at some of the issues associated with intellectual property. So take it away, Michael.
Thanks. Hello, everyone. Thank you for your attention, your time today. We want to talk about intellectual property from both a operating perspective and a transactional perspective. And hopefully we can allocate time pretty evenly between the two of them. I wanted to begin before each of the panelists introduce themselves, just putting intellectual property in an operation and transactional perspective into context a little bit. A couple years ago, we were working with a first-tier private equity firm, household name private equity firm, and at the same time, they were working on another leverage buyout. And we were sitting around over lunch one day, and I said to the leader of this second deal, not the one we were working on, so this target company that you're going to bid on has 5,000 patents. And 50%, this is approximately $11 billion LBO, and 50% of the target's revenue comes from out-licensing their intellectual property. What kind of due diligence are you doing to ensure you'll be able to retain that intellectual property value? And trust me, this is top quality household name private equity. And they looked at me and they said, we didn't thought about that. So they engaged us and we got ourselves in the diligence room pretty late in the process of the deal. And what we found out is that even though strategics and a number of other private equity firms had been through the diligence room before we were, there wasn't even a complete patent list. 50% of their revenue was attributable to out-licensing their intellectual property, and several groups had gone through the diligence shop and hadn't even thought about the intellectual property. What we ended up doing there is our mandate was we looked at the licenses that were outgoing, we looked at the law as it was changing, and we were able to create a sensitivity analysis around revenue streams that would either be supplemented or discounted if certain things happened under the law and either invalidated or strengthened their underlying patents. So just the premise that we wanted to start this from is that there's an enormous gulf between what intellectual property professionals understand about value and what financiers and corporations, on the other hand, understand about IP value. The world is going towards intangible asset heavy, tangible asset light corporations. So to the extent that this is leading edge at all, and I'm a Midwesterner, so I don't mean to denigrate the Midwest, but we tend to, from a technology, from an innovation perspective, trail the coasts a little bit. And the themes that we're going to talk about today are critical because I think a lot of your corporations, if they follow trends that are going on the coasts in other developed worlds, are going to become more and more tangible asset light, intangible asset heavy. And so this reorientation is something to begin to integrate into your thinking. With that, I'm the CEO of Hilco IP Merchant Banking. We're a merchant bank dedicated exclusively to intellectual property. We do advisory, we do principal investing around the deals that we advise on, and we also have an execution arm that creates value around the IP investments that we see. John Vesci is our Chief Operating Officer, but John, why don't you tell a little more about yourself?
Sure. So I'm more of the operational side of IP within our organization. And my background, I'm a patent attorney by trade, worked for a firm called Foley & Lardner that is also Midwestern System. You guys might know them. Mid-90s, I spun out of Foley, went to work for an outfit called Lucent that was spinning out of AT&T at the time. And with Lucent and Bell Labs, I started licensing patents for that company. And then with one of the spin-offs from Lucent, Aguirre Systems, which is a semiconductor business, I ran the licensing business at Aguirre for 3 or 4 years, and then joined Nortel in the summer of 2008. And you guys now know Nortel around IP from the end of the story, but I joined in the beginning of the story. Nortel brought me in the summer of 2008 to build the licensing business at Nortel because all of their competitors had licensing businesses bringing in meaningful bottom line, you know, straight to the bottom line revenue, high margin revenue. I love the portfolio. I love the fact that it hadn't been encumbered because they hadn't been active with their portfolio, and came in thinking this is the greatest opportunity in the world. There's tons of value here, which I was right. It just indirectly worked out differently. Nortel filed for bankruptcy 5 months after I joined, because I joined right before the Big Short happened, if you look at it from the movie perspective. And then when the Big Short happened, that kind of threw Nortel into a bankruptcy tailspin. 3 years later, at the end of summer of 2011, as a lot of people know, Nortel sold through the bankruptcy, liquidated all of its different businesses. The businesses in aggregate sold for $3.2 billion. Excuse me, the patent portfolio and my team sold for $4.5 billion. So we were a little more than 50% of the value within the entire enterprise. And as Michael was using his analogy, I can go back to the early days of the bankruptcy and guarantee you that none of the really, really smart people in the room understood that there was any value in the IP whatsoever, and argued strenuously with us that there's no way we should be treating those patents as if they're as valuable as some of these businesses we're trying to sell. So it's an interesting macro perspective relative to some of the other companies you guys might be involved in.
More specifically, sorry, to John's point, John was the chief intellectual property officer of Nortel during their 363 liquidation. The portfolio that they sold went for $4.5 billion, and John's investment banker was Lazard Frere at the time. John made an over-under bet at $500 million for the sale of that portfolio, and Lazard took the under. So it gives you a sense of this enormous dislocation in knowledge.
I think he was also a University of Chicago guy.
I'm Adam Gill. My background is a patent litigator. I spent most of my time at Kirkland & Ellis here in Chicago, where I was a partner in their IP group. In 2013, I joined Gertchen Keller Capital, which is a litigation funding shop, and we were acquired by Burford Capital in December, just this past year. So now I'm at Burford Capital, and I field requests for all kinds of different funding relating to IP. Primarily, though, that breaks down to litigation funding or asset purchases in the IP world.
Hi, everyone. My name is Raymond Zenkich. I'm a managing partner at Red Chalk Group. We're a local Chicago management consulting firm. We have a dedicated intellectual property practice. And for us, we really focus on two questions, some of which are similar to what John and Michael focus on, which is helping companies understand or do due diligence around transactions. So it can be a company that's being acquired or making an acquisition or a private equity firm. And we also help with the management of IP. So simple questions like, what should our portfolio have in it, or what's in our portfolio? And at times, we are shocked at when people ask us to help us figure that out for them. Companies worth hundreds of millions of dollars not knowing what's in their patent portfolio. And similar to the Nortel situation, maybe in a smaller scale, not really knowing that perhaps there's value that can be tapped that they aren't really thinking about fully.
So to begin the first half of the discussion about operating value creation, I wanted to divide that into monetization, corporate finance, and strategy. So starting with monetization, oftentimes the best opportunity, and maybe you can speak a little to this, Ray, is mining portfolios within corporations that are not core to the operating business and therefore oftentimes lost attention, but have a lot of value that you can get your arms around.
No, that's absolutely true. And it's typically related to the size of the company or company has been very acquisitive over time. They may have a portfolio of several thousand patents. We've done this very often where a company may have 3,000 or 4,000 patents. and help answer that first question, what do we have? And then as you begin to understand the portfolio, the questions come up around, are the patents or the, more broadly speaking, the intellectual properties that supporting our business in a meaningful way? If so, are there any other ways to monetize it? Or as Michael mentioned, is it perhaps no longer a part of our business and may have been divested, and perhaps they retain the IP through good negotiations, and it, perhaps it may have a lot of value because it may be in an industry outside of theirs. We may get into why that type of IP is perhaps the most interesting for companies to have in their portfolio. The trick then becomes, what we've found at least, is driving that company to want to do something. So you may identify a set of patents that, let's say, are considered non-core, that is, in a non-adjacent or separate industry they're no longer in. And let's say maybe there's a valuation you can attach to it. It can become a challenge to convince senior management to actually go and pursue that valuation, that opportunity. I'm curious, Michael, you guys, what you've seen. I know we've had a very hard time at times to, for companies who may not be used to thinking about licensing. You mentioned your example. I mean, there's times where people just don't know what the options are, and today there are in fact a lot of options to consider.
So, in addition to mining for dormant or unutilized assets in a company's portfolio, another source of opportunity we see a lot is what we call the kiss your sister situation, where a company could out-license its IP, but its competitors are its customers. And generally, if they try to license to those guys, it hurts commercial relationships, and there's a very real risk that their customer has IP that they'll assert, netting out to zero and there's no licensing. So a lot of times, companies like to move their IP out into new entities, special purpose vehicles, who will do the assertion and make that bilateral relationship triangular and create real value licensing. But now that we've talked a little bit about sort of sources of IP within corporations, let's talk a little bit about how you create value around it. And John and Adam represent two very important poles of how that value is created. John is a licensing professional fundamentally, and I'd like him to speak a little bit about value creation around licensing. But when licensing doesn't work, particularly in this legal regime where there's a tremendous amount of patent holdout, sometimes you got to pull out the club, and Adam's the club. So first we'll have John talk a little about licensing, and then Adam about litigation and litigation funding as a source of monetization value creation.
Sure, just in general. Okay, I don't know if anyone has any questions about the way patent licensing tends to work, but as Raymond pointed out, sometimes you have assets that may or may not balance with what it is you're selling. I think that's often the case. If you have a choice between having a patent that covers exactly what you do as a company or a patent that covers exactly what other people do, you'd much rather have the latter than the former. To license somebody, you're not usually trying to force yourself to pay yourself a license fee. You're trying to get somebody else out there who's infringing and happens to use your patents to pay a fee. So if you have non-core assets, that's often ideal because it's not directly in the same market where you are. It might be in other markets, and if you can exploit that market and identify how people out there are using your technology, then that's the perfect recipe or perfect situation for trying to assert your patents and develop a licensing business around them. So a business itself that's a licensing business, the key ingredients are, of course, you have to have the assets, then you have to have the wherewithal to figure out if the assets are any good, and if people are actually infringing them, figure out what markets the infringement is occurring in, building a business plan around that, having the ability to do reverse engineering, which is something we do organically, pulling things apart to prove that the infringement actually occurs, developing something we call a claim chart, which is basically a PowerPoint presentation walking people through how our patents cover what it is you're doing, and then trying to enter into a license negotiation with the infringer to have them basically pay for an easement to walk across your property, essentially. You know, to think about it as if you have the land that's between them and the beach and they want to go to the beach, and instead of walking around your property, they want to walk straight through. Well, that's what a license is, essentially. It's giving them the opportunity to infringe on your property because it's to their advantage, and you get some sort of reward in exchange for that, and that's sort of the transaction. But as Michael said, and as Adam's in the business of, rarely do people, if I couldn't tell the cops to stop you from walking across my property to the beach, then you're not going to pay me because you're just going to keep doing it. And the equivalent of the cops telling you to stop trespassing is litigating and enforcing your patents in the courts, and that's where Adam comes in.
So Adam, before you start, when you talk about litigation financing and funding generally, I think one thing we've already skipped over in this discussion, which is critical, is what is patent quality? And you're probably best suited to talk about it because it's really, if it isn't present, you're not financing it. So what is some of that indicia that you are looking for?
Well, that is a very important question. There are a lot of metrics that people have developed to analyze portfolios, but we really look at it on a case-by-case basis. You know, the quality of IP really boils down to, I think, is it valid and is it useful? Right? And, with patents, to be valid, you have to meet some of the technical requirements that people in this room probably are not that interested in learning about, but then also you have to, it has to be new, right, and not obvious. So you really have to look and get an understanding of what the technology was at the time the patent was filed, in order to get an honest view of, is this a useful improvement? How much of an improvement is it? And then you look to, you know, who's using it. Sometimes people have an idea of who's using it. Sometimes it's more open-ended. You have to do a lot of times reverse engineering. A lot of these things tend to be kind of high-tech, semiconductor software type stuff, type of matters. And then you have to look at, is there a way around it? Right? Even it could be useful, it could be infringed to some extent, but if there's a workaround, it's not going to be terribly valuable. But those are things we look at in evaluating it.
Michael, if I can add just one point to that, because I think at times it's challenging to be very practical. And if you're a small or medium-sized company, you don't have a team of people maybe able to answer those questions, right? Is it valid? Is it useful? Or how could it be used? Especially if it's outside of your industry. One of the things that many people do, even large companies specifically, they'll listen. So the market will oftentimes call them. It could be a patent broker, for example, saying, we want to buy this patent from you. That's a very strong signal that perhaps it is valid and useful. And oftentimes, if you're an executive, it may just be as simple as calling up your head of IP or maybe your outside counsel and asking that question, have we had any inbound requests around our portfolio?
I just want to make one last practical point. Don't confuse good ideas and great innovation with valuable IP when you're wearing your corporate hat. Valuable intellectual property is that intellectual property that, because of novelty, validity, and infringement, you can force somebody to pay you for. The next thing we're going to transition into is corporate finance. And all the time, we have people come to us with wonderful innovations that may or may not ever be implemented, and therefore may or may not ever create value. And we end up with a lot of very disappointed people who have developed great innovations, but because they've never been implemented, because they've never been commercialized, there's no ability to create value around them. So one of the things is we moved to corporate finance, and we're principally talking here about IP collateralized lending. You have to be very, very able up front to demonstrate cash flows to support the debt that you're looking for. And nobody will finance with debt against IP that will be commercialized at some point in the future. And that's another frustration we run into all the time. People with great IP that has not been implemented or commercialized by somebody probably should go try and get equity financing or venture funding, but it isn't debt funding. And it's important that you realize sort of that distinction. Ray, when you are talking to people about assets that might potentially be used as collateral in a loan, are there any things that you look for in particular about what would qualify as adequate collateral, or any feelings that you have or any sense of how you look at value for purposes of collateral as opposed to value for purposes of sale?
That's a great question. I think in the few times I've been involved in collateralized options, it's typically fallen pretty close to typical sort of patent valuation, right? Is it being infringed, size of markets, addressability, kind of just working the model to understand potential damages. I think I'll defer to your expertise there, Michael.
So how do you think about loan to value? Or you, I could give some thoughts of you.
Yeah, I'm not an expert there.
It's very interesting. There's two ways that people think about intellectual property value from a more organized or traditional perspective. One, you look at it from sort of a discounted cash flow perspective. And the other, of course, is a market value. What can you liquidate them for? And all the time, people come to us looking to borrow against their IP because somebody has given them a valuation that says, our IP is worth X. And when you dig into that valuation, you see that it's premised upon assumptions that all of the patents are valid, all of the patents are infringed, and that they captured 100% of the market. Well, in most cases, none of those three infringement or assumptions are 100% correct. So what you end up having to do, if you're going to try and loan against projected cash flows, is develop a net present value for those cash flows. And then generally, we'll only lend 20 to 25% against the net present value of those cash flows. Because if your calculation is correct, that 20 to 25% value probably is a pretty close proxy for market value, assuming there's liquidity for the underlying collateral.
And that's when you're talking about projected potential cash flows, not actual cash flows.
Right.
If you don't have a cash flow stream attached to it, it's speculative, and the transaction costs are high. So you need a multiple to make sure that you're protected.
Right.
And to that point, Michael, we in our experience, it's typically a 10 to 15 multiple we see. So we kind of back it off that number.
Mm-hmm.
If it's got a further discount, as you're identifying, then yeah, it's probably even beyond that.
Yeah, the irony is that in reality, it's counterintuitive, but the patents that have the most well-defined cash flow associated with them are probably the least valuable patents because the cash flow is basically representing the value that the patents would have had if they weren't already licensed. The cash flow comes with the licenses. So I tend to think of a patent as almost like a balance sheet. And on one side of the balance sheet is all of the potential value. This is kind of like Nortel's portfolio before when I showed up. They hadn't licensed anybody, so there's a lot of potential energy. And on the other hand, if you license your patent out and people are paying for the ability to use your patent, everybody who's paying for the ability to use your patent, it's almost like they're taking another stick out of the bundle of sticks that create your property right. Each licensee creates cash flow, but they also encumber your asset. And the more licensees you get, the weaker and weaker and weaker your asset, in fact, is, but you have very, very strong cash flow. So we'll debate, are you actually valuing the asset or are you valuing the cash flow that goes with the asset? Because they're kind of indirect.
If I could answer that, John, because one of the things we'll do, back of the envelope, if I know nothing about your patent portfolio, let's say there are 100 patents, just as an example, and the people on the stage know this very well, a very small fraction of that portfolio typically has any value. And let's assume 2 to 5% of the patents, so 5 patents, probably best case, have any value. Then the question becomes, okay, what is that value? And again, back of the envelope, no information about the patent or the industry. You know, today in the current market, you can probably attach a value of, I would say, $200,000 to maybe on the high end, $500,000 for a patent family. Again, knowing nothing about the specific assets. You can start understanding, you start bounding the problem at this point, and you discount that based on some numbers you've seen here. And the numbers, if it's not a huge, massive portfolio, you can begin to see where it may not be incredibly attractive to think about licensing. But with those rough parameters, remember, you may have a portfolio like Nortel's, where it was maybe a higher percentage given the great R&D that was done. You might be in an industry where the families are worth $5 million each. So that's where you need the expertise to kind of come in and help you answer what the reality of the valuation is.
And one of the challenges fundamentally behind all of this, especially if they're homegrown assets, they're not on your balance sheet. So there's nobody programmatically trying to figure this out quarter after quarter like they are with other assets within your company, where you're trying to tell the street, if you're public, how valuable your assets are. The patents are sort of survive in the background somewhere. If they're acquired as part of a M&A transaction, maybe they've been valued at some point. But often they're not. They're just sort of accumulate.
Yeah, that's very true. We see a lot. The legal department that handles the part of the legal department that handles patents chugs along on their own. They're typically not monitored heavily. And then when you have a situation where the business turns to them and says, okay, what about your value? Either they need cash or maybe there's a big licensing deal. We've seen that before. And then everybody says, wait, there's money over there? And then they say, oh, you know, what else is there? And then all of a sudden you've got, you know, attention directed toward this, you know, bucket of assets that haven't looked at it in a valuation type way before. They typically look at it in a competitive way, you know, how to block out competitors or how to have defensive tools. And so it's actually surprising to see even the number of, you know, Fortune 50, Fortune 100 companies who have, you know, fairly low level of understanding about what's in their IP and their licensing as well. A lot of times they don't have like, a good handle on inbound and outbound licensing as well.
Well, even in my case, I remember up in Lake Forest at the Deer Path Inn having lunch with Mike Zafirowski when I was joining Nortel. And I showed him how the business I was running, how we ran things, and how and what the metrics were that we used for the patents we were getting, whatever. And then he looks at me and goes, well, how do we do it at Nortel? And I then flipped the tab and said, well, here's how you guys do it. But it wasn't like he was telling me this is how we do it, because it just wasn't the conversation that they normally have in the C-suite. I had to educate him as to how it was actually being done within his own company. Yeah, it's almost like we're the basement closet or the junk drawer of the company in some ways, and things just sort of accumulate, but not a lot of tender, loving care.
So that's a good segue into the last of the topics we want to do under operational value creation, which is strategy, because we can expand on that a little bit. But before we move into strategy, I just want to make one point about how monetization, corporate finance can often be oppositional, and you have to sort of think about it. Typically, if you're going to use your intellectual property as collateral for a loan, there'll be negative covenants that preclude you from doing things like monetizing your portfolio, because inevitably monetization requires litigation. The first thing a defendant will try and do is invalidate your patents. If he's successful, he wipes out the collateral value for the loan. So oftentimes you can't do everything and you need to make some choices. So with that, I wanted to segue a little bit into a discussion of how you almost audit a company and how you approach a company to help them develop a strategy. John, I know you're doing quite a bit of that now. So, you know, one of the companies that John and I are working with right now is a phenomenal company that I wish I could tell you about it, but it will shake the world. But they're technologists and they're not doing anything to protect their intellectual property. So they're developing great innovation, but they're not protecting it. And they've effectively asked us to come in and say, help, create an IP strategy so that we don't find out tomorrow that we've educated the world on our backs and lose all of our value.
I'd almost say that they're kind of innovative in how self-aware they are that they don't know what they're doing around IP, because 99% of companies would be doing exactly the same thing these guys are, accumulating the crap in the basement or the junk drawer, but have no real vision until too late as to, well, now what do we have? That's when they bring in, you know, like Raymond, for example, or us, and say, well, help us figure this out. In these guys' case, instead, they realize, well, what we're doing is extremely valuable, and let's make sure we build the portfolio from the beginning so that it's the right kind of portfolio to either help us as a hedge on our operational plan, or just that the plan down the road when we're making tons of money will be via the IP. But it's not common for people to think that way, because usually there's to admit that you don't actually know is not something easy, especially for lawyers, and especially for patent lawyers. I mean, you're probably even more risk averse than the typical lawyer if you went in the patent space. But to actually admit, okay, we know what we know, but it'd be nice to have people that actually have done the licensing and can look at our portfolio from the perspective of a portfolio that they want to license or a portfolio they want to litigate, or both? And how do we build it now, create the facts today that we want to be able to litigate down the road? That's the key part.
We've seen the problem from the other side. So if you're a large, let's say, consumer electronics company, that industry changes so quickly, even with an unlimited R&D budget, you cannot be placing R&D bets in all the areas you should be. And so what we see is companies will see where there's technology area, and they're pursuing perhaps one, two, or three of, let's say, the options, the outcomes, but there might be twice as many out there. They will, in fact, you know, engage firms like us or John and Michael's and try and find those smaller companies who may have the other paths that are being pursued. One of those six or 10 is going to win. So they want to acquire, license that IP to kind of to hedge their bets a bit. And that presents an opportunity for a small company that's being very innovative, because it can be a lifeline, because they may get licensing revenue and an ability to partner with a large consumer electronics to kind of shape the development of what they're developing. So it doesn't always have to be seen as almost adversarial. Mm-hmm. It can be complementary at times.
Adam, can you talk a little bit about the puts and takes around whether or not you want to be an operating company when you're asserting from a strategy perspective?
You mean a plaintiff in a patent lawsuit?
Right.
Whether that's, I think you'd always,
what are the puts and takes there?
Generally, you always want to be an operating company because you have to convince 12 people to give you a lot of money, right? And a story always goes a lot farther than, hey, I bought these patents and they're really smart, give me some money. So, you know, from a, you know, our ideology is that, you know, patents have the attributes of personal property. It says that in the patent statute, and it doesn't matter to me if somebody sells them and passes them around, because otherwise patents would only have value in the hands of people who have factories. And if you're an inventor and you go to somebody who's using your patent, you say, hey, do you want to license it? They'd say no, it doesn't have value because you have it. You say, hey, do you want to buy it? They say no, because it doesn't have any value because you have it. So that's that. But from a litigation strategy perspective, it's always better to have the patents where they originated or where they're being used. The asterisk on that is the blowback, right? So if an operating company sues a competitor, somebody's using their patents, then the first thing that company will do oftentimes is mine their own portfolio or look to go out on the open market to find assets to assert back against the original company. I mean, the transaction costs, I guess it's an opportunity that allows us to have a lot of things to look at, but it's still frustrating at the same time. Like, the transaction costs in the space are huge.
So the reason why we're sort of talking about this in the context of strategy, as we said before, you know, on the one hand, the kiss your sister situation suggests that you should transfer assets away from the operating company. But Adam's point is that puts you at a disadvantage when you're trying to monetize and you end up in litigation. So it's just one more element of strategy that needs to be balanced when considering how you're going to monetize your portfolio from an operational perspective.
There's things in the middle you can do, right? You can move them to a small company who's developing products and they'll have less exposure. Rockstar, when they monetized their portfolio, when they were in suit, they did something that was extremely clever, which was tie it back to the pensions of the people who did the R&D at Nortel. So it wasn't just a strict financial sale. It was still supporting the R&D and supporting the pensions of the people who worked at this company that's no longer in business. That was very clever.
So moving a little bit to transactional, yes, please.
So it's not easier than you think. Patents are territorial in nature, so a U.S. patent just covers the U.S. There's no global patent. If you want to get patents in other countries, generally, as a U.S.-centric person, and this is probably pretty true even if you're not U.S.-based, usually almost every invention gets filed in the U.S. because it's the best market for the most mature legal system. So you get your good bang for your buck. And then you'll usually file in a few countries in Europe and a few countries in Asia, theoretically. But then you have to file your cases in those particular jurisdictions. So usually, as a licensing guy, I won't think about a Chinese company that's making just for sale in China as even a viable target, because it's gonna, the only place I can go after them is I could sue them in China, and I'm somebody outside there suing in China, and it just doesn't seem like it'd be worth it. Generally, the Chinese damages are fairly low, but that doesn't mean I can't sue Apple, for example, in China on behalf of somebody who's licensing to Huawei. Let's say Huawei's a licensee of mine already, and Apple's infringing. That's a much different equation. The damages, again, in China aren't that as good as they'd be in the United States, but you still could theoretically sue in China, sue in Germany, or whatever. So usually you have to have a multi-jurisdiction perspective, assuming the patents are in multiple jurisdictions.
We could put all sorts of facets of complication around your question. It's a very difficult one. Another one is that you can't divorce politics from economics. And oftentimes, if you're talking about politics, you're talking about law. So maybe by the transitive theory, you can't divorce economics from law. And for example, China right now is very much trying to have people enter their markets. And they're trying to establish themselves as a rule of law jurisdiction on par with the West. And so you see a very, very pro-patent owner regime in China. And in some instances, for international corporations, they're even trying to find China as a favorable venue, even though, as John said, the damage awards tend to be lower. In the United States right now, we're in a period where our law is incredibly anti-patent. And if you believe that patents subsidize innovation, to be anti-patent is in some respects innovation, and we're really doing some real damage to our country right now. But people take advantage of that by increasingly asserting in places like China or in Germany, places that are more receptive to patent assertion, specifically because they're trying to import innovation. So that's a dynamic that also figures into the territorial question.
But for example, I've done deals with companies like Huawei or ZTE or SMIC that are all Chinese-centric that export out of China, and then it's a much different equation. Because the patent gives you the right, and then maybe that's one-on-one stuff here, it's a negative right. It gives you the right to stop other people from doing certain things, make, use, sell, offer to sell, import. So I could stop you from making it if I have the Chinese patent, or I could stop you from importing it or selling it in the United States based on the U.S. patent. And often that'll govern those conversations, is which markets, what are the bigger markets? We'll usually almost always show people the U.S. patents. And then if you're doing a worldwide license with somebody, invariably you'll put a certain weight on the U.S. ones and a smaller weight on ones in other jurisdictions and come up with some sort of blended rate at the end of the day that you'd like to apply to worldwide sales. That's usually the way it applies.
If I could just add one quick point, because it does tie back to valuation. So if a target, for example, has a lot of revenue coming from Germany, for example, and they have a 100 patent portfolio, and all of which are in the U.S. with no members in Germany, that's a huge red flag. And we've seen, not that extreme, but we've seen several examples like that where the jurisdictional coverage that John refers to, does it match to the actual revenues of the company?
So moving to...
There's a question over there, Mike.
Sorry?
There's a question over there.
I'm sorry.
Are you seeing an uptick or impact from cyber thieves, you know, trying to come into the market, steal their patents or steal the value in some way, and then, or ransom it in some, where they're accelerating trying to get their valuation?
Honestly, cyber theft is just a means to an end that happens. You know, intellectual property theft happens with all different degrees of sophistication. And I can't say I personally have seen cyber penetrations as the modus of the theft. But to me, it's just theft, and it happens in the most sophisticated ways and the least sophisticated ways.
I think in the world of trade secrets, it could in fact be far more pronounced. I'm not an expert there, maybe John, and you may have some thoughts on that, but certainly other countries or competitors trying to get access to trade secrets, another form of IP, can also be equally damaging.
That's a very important distinction. Patents give you a 20-year monopoly in exchange for complete disclosure of the invention that was being protected by the patent. A trade secret, you say to yourself, it's not worth the monopoly. I would rather just keep this secret to myself, but thereby have no protection. I mean, for example, the recipe for Coke was never patented, because if you were going to patent it, you would have had to disclose to everybody how to make Coke. Coke decided we're going to keep that a secret. So Ray is exactly right. Cyber does come in a lot more in the trade secret case than in the patent case, because methodologies disclosed in patents.
And the benefit to Coke 100 years later, their formula is still a secret, whereas if they filed for a patent, if they came to me 100 years ago, I would advise them to file for a patent, and they would have had 20 years of protection, and now everybody would know how to make it. I would have thought, well, you're going to sell this all over the world, and anybody, you know, can just buy it and reverse engineer it and figure out what's in it, so why would you not want to protect it? It just, it's still not intuitive to me why nobody knows what the heck's in it, if it's being sold anywhere. But to what Michael said before about how patents are, it's sort of the climate right now in the United States is anti-patent. That's leading a lot of companies to focus much more on trade secrets, because they can control them and keep them secret, and then you're opening yourselves up to that sort of cyber threat. Once it's out there, once it's public, you're hosed.
But the nature of the nature of trade secrets generally are that they can't be reverse engineered, because they're only a trade secret for as long as they're a secret, and if somebody can go in and reverse engineer them, then there's no trade secret anymore. So if that, you have a couple problems there, detecting and then announcing trade secret theft, right? Because for one, people don't want to say, hey, we just got hacked and we lost a huge amount of our value because somebody took it, and then how do you find out who did it? That's another, you know, huge problem. And if you see it on the market, just by its nature, it doesn't lend itself to reverse engineering, so it's going to be very difficult to detect if you can't kind of draw a straight line with theft.
So we only have a few more minutes, so I will, and we haven't yet started on transactional value creation around M&A, or excuse me, around IP. But let me just pause and see if there's any questions sort of about this operational stuff, and maybe we can knock out the questions. If there are no questions, we can move into sort of more of the transactional stuff.
So my question was about the trade secrets kind of intellectual property. How do you make an estimate of the value of it?
So
go ahead.
Unlike patents, where you can evaluate it as if you're going to build a licensing business around it, trade secret, by definition, the value is in the fact that you're not licensing it to anybody. So it's what is the differentiation it gives you in margin relative to others. You know, it's a barrier to entry, and somehow that you've got the secret. And I think you have to do a kind of an A-B test. How much are we worth with this being secret? How much would we be worth if it wasn't secret? And that the delta between the two is the value.
Well, and the way to think about it.
I was thinking about it from an acquisition standpoint. So if you're going to acquire a company with trade secrets.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think this is how you do it. If you have a patent, you think about what cash flows can you generate from licensing. If you have a trade secret, a trade secret will have zero value if you yourself are not commercializing it, right? So then you can look at the cash flows that come from the products that are created due to your trade secret and value it that way.
And the margin delta between operating with the trade secret in the company of the future that you're in anticipating or not, and then that'll give you the gap.
What's the incremental value of using it? Or you can license it out. You got to be very careful, because once it's not a secret, it's not a secret. But it looks like tech transfer, right? People do that, and you could out-license, but you have to make sure you trust the party that you're licensing it out to, and that you have very strong protections.
I can throw a wrench into the works, but I think In the patent world, if you've already licensed your patent, as John mentioned, that becomes an encumbrance, right? That there's you're already licensing your patent to someone. Around a trade secret, and I'm not an attorney, so I'm speaking to a layperson. One of the key questions I would ask if valuing a trade secret is I would want to understand all of the policies and procedures you had in place to make sure that was in fact a trade secret and it was being maintained as such. Because if, for example, you handed your trade secret to all your employees every year, you no longer have a trade secret. So that's one important thing to keep in mind around trade secrets.
And if somebody independently develops it, there's no claim against that. It's really just kind of a theft claim. If you have a secret, somebody steals it, you get compensated.
So if there's no any screaming questions, maybe we can just end with a transactional anecdote. Are we basically out of time? Oh, okay, good. So we will spend, let me tell you a story about AOL circa 2011, 2012. Starboard Value Partners, a very active activist, went to AOL and said, you've got a market cap of about $1 billion. We've looked at your IP portfolio, and we think your IP portfolio is worth $2 billion. And on top of that, you have a very profitable, or relatively profitable, operating company. So we think you should go sell half your IP portfolio for $1 billion. Now, you're probably thinking, well, AOL's a pretty tech-savvy company. They're probably on top of what they're doing. If there can't be a bunch of activists coming in and telling AOL that they've completely missed their own value or have done nothing around value creation in the public market. But in fact, they go out and they put half their IP portfolio up for sale. Microsoft buys it for $1 billion. So anyone who owned AOL at the time got the second half of the IP portfolio in the operating business for free. That started a catalyst that made people start looking at AOL as an operating company. And ultimately, 2.5 years later, Verizon bought AOL for $4 billion. And that's obviously net of the billion that was distributed on the sale of the IP. So there is tremendous latent value in companies around their IP. And if people don't identify the IP value to start with, you get AOL pre-Starboard. And if you begin to think about it proactively, then maybe you can make AOL at $4 billion before the activist comes, instead of letting an activist come in, toss you out of your job, and transfer value to their investors. So M&A is a very, very powerful way to capture value around intellectual property. And I think we can break it into whole company acquisitions and just IP asset specific acquisitions. It's a extremely interesting thing. We sort of talked about the whole company acquisition. On the IP asset sale acquisition, that's a very, very interesting and potential value creative exercise for investors because basically, if you're buying intellectual property that hasn't been commercialized, you're not only valuing it on the potential value of the IP, but you're putting a big discount on it as a buyer for the risk transfer. And the earlier stage an IP portfolio is around commercialization, and the more willing an investor is in taking that commercialization, that licensing, that monetization bet, you can buy at deeper and deeper discounts. Now, when we look to invest in IP portfolios that are in advance of being commercialized, we won't even really dig in if we can't believe, because of the discount that I'm speaking to, that we can't generate 35% IRRs. And if you think about that from an investment perspective in this market, I don't know anything else that has that kind of risk-adjusted returns and that lack of correlation to the broad market and other investment strategies. So this notion that we're talking about, we believe collectively that there's tremendous unexploited deep value in IP. And just to bring the point full circle, these arbitrage opportunities exist because corporations and Wall Street don't appreciate the value that can be created if you're willing to assume the risk. And we can all tell you that we're really in the first, and I mean first, I don't mean second, the first inning of value creation around value realization, value creation, value arbitrage around IP. And it shocks me to this day, having come from Wall Street and being in IP now, that this gap is as wide as it is and is as persistent as it is. I mean, I'm incredibly used to seeing big arbitrage opportunities disappear because people jump on them and realize the value creation opportunity. But I've been in IP now for 10 years after having run a $4 billion hedge fund, and that hedge fund principally made its money in merger arbitrage. When I was running merger arbitrage, it was a 20-25% annualized return strategy that got marginalized to a low single-digit return strategy. There is absolutely no compression in value creation around intellectual property. And it's because it's hard. It's because we're still in the first couple innings of it. People don't appreciate how to exploit the value. But I think that we collectively would implore all of you that represent corporations or investors to begin exploring that value and mining it, because not only are asset-like corporations the direction of the developed world and where we're going, but it's where the value lies.
No question.
It depends on a lot of variables, right? How many assets, how many different fields of use those assets can be put to, whether or not there is precedent for commercializing the technology, whether it's foundational technology, whether it's derivative technology, whether it's technology that goes into a component, that is a component of something like a cell phone, or whether it's a standalone technology like a buggy whip. So we've done situations where we've valued small portfolios in a matter of weeks, and for very, very large portfolios that can be exploited in a lot of different dimensions, it could take 6 months to a year to value them.
Yeah, it's our experience as well. It can go from weeks to months. I mean, it really depends on the size of the portfolio, the industry, the level of precision perhaps, or how much risk you want to take off the table. It's both of those.
And part, it might depend on what you need the valuation for as well.
That's a good point. Anybody else? All right, well, thank you very much. Thank you.